keep.
Chairman of the session, CA Khandelwal ji, Ramesh Chukhani ji, CA Bajrangal ji, convener of the study circle, CA Vijay Kumar Agrawal ji, CA Raj Singhania ji, senior members from the profession. At the outset, first of all, let me thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to be here today with you. In fact, I am aware of the fact that I am here because Dr. Girish Ahuja could not stay for the second part because of his other commitments, and therefore I got this opportunity to be here with you. A small incident I can share with you regarding a person who has to come as an alternate speaker, as a substitute speaker. You would have heard of the famous scientist Einstein, right? Now, Einstein had developed a phenomena which was new to everyone. He had developed it, so only he knew about it. So in order to give his deliberations, he had to go to various places to explain to the persons what was the phenomena that he has developed. So he went to about 8-10 lectures. His driver, his personal driver, also used to go with him. So he asked the driver, why wait in the sun? You can also come and sit at the back of the hall. So the driver also attended about 10-15 seminars, and then he said, sir, aap kya lecture dete ho, ye to main bhi de diya karunga. To ek din usne kaha, acha agle seminar mein aap hi lecture dena. To usko coat wot pehna ke wo aa gaya. Ab Einstein ka aapko kuch janta to tha nahi. To unhone samjha yahi hoga, usne aake first class lecture jo Einstein saab dete the usne bhi bada bada de diya. 15 baar hi sun chuka tha. अब उसके बाद सेशन आया क्वेश्चन आंसर का. अब प्रॉब्लम शुरू हुई. अब जो नॉर्मल क्वेश्चंस होते थे वो तो उसने सुने हुए थे, दे दिए. अब जब एक्चुअल बाउंसर शुरू हुए, जो नई चीजें थी जिसके बारे में उसको पता नहीं था, अब ड्राइवर साहब परेशान कि मैं अब इसका आंसर कैसे दूं, मुझे तो कुछ पता नहीं. बट वो चलाक आदमी था, उसने सिचुएशन को क्या हैंडल करा. कहता, सर देखिए ये सिंपल क्वेश्चंस हैं आपके, और इसके लिए मैं अपने ड्राइवर को बुला लेता हूं, तो आपके क्वेश्चंस का तो मेरा ड्राइवर भी आंसर दे देगा. तो फिर उधर से उन जो पीछे बैठे थे आइंस्टाइन साहब वो आए और उन्होंने उसको आंसर दे दिए. बट अनफॉर्चुनेटली आज हमारे आइंस्टाइन साहब हमारे पास नहीं है, तो सारे सवाल जवाब हमें खुद ही करने पड़ेंगे. So we'll try to make the best of the session. Before I come to the topic on hand, kuch baatein pehle hui thi. My name was mentioned several times by Dr. Girish Ahuja also regarding the committee which has been formed by the Government of India. And I find that a lot of people have interest in that. So I would like to devote some time, few minutes, for the deliberations of that committee. As you would be aware, the Government of India last month constituted this tax reform committee. I am also a member of that panel. The terms of reference for this committee are, we have to suggest measures for simplification of the tax law, specifically income tax. How can we avoid litigations in tax matters? And how can we introduce ease of doing business through the tax laws? So these are the broad terms of reference. On this, we have been inviting suggestions from the various chambers, various chartered accountants also have been giving suggestions. And in fact, on this committee, there are about 4 persons who are from your profession, they are chartered accountants. We also have 4 members, 4 senior members from the department. And the chairman is, of course, a retired judge of the High Court. Fortunately, he's a person who is well aware of the tax matters. He himself was the president of the ITAT. And he has been handling tax matters for a number of years, so he understands tax very well. We have already had 2 meetings of this committee. Is it audible? Now, they have a very rigid mindset. And it is very difficult. I think this should be better. Now the mindset of the income tax officials is very different, and we are finding it very difficult to convince them as to what are the problems that are faced by the taxpayers and the practitioners. See, one of the concepts that we raise there is of the concept that is being debated upon is tax terrorism. Right? We said that we should try to delete the provisions which assume an assessee to be a thief, which are assuming an assessee to be corrupt, right? For example, to be an evader, for example, we are arguing that provisions of Section 50C are draconian, especially in today's world, where the actual sale consideration is many times much less than the stamp duty value. So why are you assuming that every person will evade tax and therefore impose a tax on a hypothetical value? So 50C should be done away with. This is also not in spirit with the principles laid down by the Supreme Court. You have a case of K.P. Verghese where the court said that you cannot presume a person to be a culprit. So if you find evidence against a person, please punish him. But do not presume a person to be a culprit. So we are advocating that Section 50C, like a deeming provision, Section 43CA, all these provisions should be done away with. Right, that will raise the confidence level also of the taxpayers. And wherever there is a scope for arbitrariness, those provisions should be amended so that we have a certainty in the tax laws. Right? As there is certainty, then the problem of corruption itself will be taken care of. Right? But the problem that they raise is that they say that you say that the officials are corrupt, but who makes them corrupt? It is the taxpayer who goes to them and offers the money. So you can't just blame the tax department. Right? So that to a certain extent is correct also, because we, in order to hide our own faults, we offer the money to the department officials. Because of that, they are emboldened. So if we have certain tax provisions which are certain, which no one can bring in any arbitrariness, there is no subjectivity in the provisions, then I think we can combat this problem of tax terrorism also. Tax terrorism also arises, as Sir just mentioned, as Kandigal is saying, in the case of search and surveys, where there's a lot of pressure being exerted on the taxpayer. To what extent can we dilute that? Right, we'll just go through the provisions and then we will try to analyze as to how can we avoid these provisions. In the light of this, whatever suggestions you have, you are welcome to please forward them to me. Mr. Vinod Jain is also a member of this committee. So any person that you can catch hold of, or I'll give you my email address, you can forward those suggestions to me. And we will take care that these are sufficiently taken care of in the deliberations. Any other suggestions that you would like to make? Any broad suggestions for this committee, for this panel? If you have any particular suggestions, of course, as I told you, you can send it to us. We will take care of them. So then, coming to the topic on hand of search and surveys, I will deal only with the critical issues, the contentious issues we will deal with, the normal procedure we all know. As regards the search, you know the provisions are contained in, the procedure is contained in Section 132. Who can authorize a search? What is the purpose of the search? What are the circumstances? What are the powers, etc.? Those are given in Section 132. And then the procedure of assessment is given in 153A, B, and C. Right, so we will briefly go through these provisions. Penalty in case of search cases specifically covered under 271AA(b). So what is the penalty which can be imposed? That also we will discuss. Survey, we have only one section, 133A. So starting with the search, as you know, Section 132 empowers the income tax authorities to order for a search. The hierarchy is given as to which are the officers who can authorize a search. Right? They are all senior officers up to the rank of joint commissioner. They are authorized to record a satisfaction and then order for a search. Although search may be actually undertaken by any officer of the rank of even the assessing officer. But it has to be authorized by the person of the rank of joint commissioner and above. What is the basis of conducting a search? As per 132, there are three basic reasons which have been identified. The basis could be either a person to whom summon under 131 has been issued or notice under 142 has been issued and he has not produced his books of accounts. He has failed to furnish any information asked by the Income Tax Department. So that could lead to a search. Second is, where the department feels that if any such notice is issued, the assessee will not comply with that. So this is only an assumption. Right? Circumstantial evidence that the assessee will not comply with that, that also gives him a power. And third basic reason is, where most of the searches are undertaken, that the assessee, according to the department, has any assets, including bullion, jewelry, cash, etc., which is not disclosed or which would not be disclosed in the returns of income. So under these three circumstances, the department has been given the power to sanction a search. The safeguard inbuilt is that the person who is authorized in the search has to record his satisfaction. And this has to be an objective satisfaction. We have Supreme Court judgments which say that merely rumors, gossip, newspaper reports, these are not sufficient for reasons to record a satisfaction. So the department must record a subjective, a valid satisfaction as to why this search is being undertaken. Can the assessee ask for this satisfaction note? When the team goes to him for a search, can he say that, show me this satisfaction note? No. The requirement is that the department has to record it. This will be produced only when you challenge the search in a court of law. So when the challenge is there before the High Court or the Supreme Court, then they can ask for these reasons. So these have to be produced before the court of law. The assessee does not have a right to ask for these satisfaction. Now, when a search is conducted, what are the powers of the search team? They can, of course, enter any premises for which they have the search warrants. They can break open any locks if the keys are not provided to them. They can, most important power, they can record the statement of any person who is available at the time of search. Now, this is a very important provision of power given to the assessing officers, to the team conducting the search. This power is given under Section 132(4). The statement can be recorded. The statement can be recorded regarding what matters? Statement can be recorded regarding the assets found, regarding the books of account found, or for any other matter which may pertain to the assessment of the assessor. So if the books of accounts are not found there, the search team can also ask, where are the books of accounts? What is your method of accounting? Where are your assets kept? What are the properties owned by you? How much jewelry do you have? What are your lockers? Right? All this information can be sought by the department in this statement. In fact, what happens is that when a search is conducted, one statement, which we call a preliminary statement, is recorded at the beginning of the search. Before they even start the search, the department, I think we have Chaitanya Sahib with us. May we request him to kindly come on the dais, please? Please, sir, your seat is here. Welcome, sir, welcome. Now, in this preliminary statement that is recorded at the beginning of the search team will take some information from the assessee. How much cash do you have at this point? where is this cash kept? What are your bank lockers? Who has the keys of the Almiras of the house? How many family members are there? Are you filing your income tax returns? Are you filing your wealth tax returns? So this preliminary information is gathered in the preliminary statement itself. They do not conclude the statement at this stage. They will continue the statement and carry on till the end of the search. So some preliminary information is taken, and then they will start the search and try to identify what items they have been found. Now, one thing I have to remember very carefully, whatever statement is given during the course of search is a valid piece of evidence which can be used against the SSC while framing the assessments. So when I am giving a statement, I have to be very careful. Can I refuse to give a statement? No. That will lead to prosecution. I cannot refuse to give a statement. I am bound to give a statement at the time of search. And the statement can be used against me. But I can be very cautious at the time of giving the statement. If they ask me to explain certain entries in my books of accounts, I can always say, I am not aware of this. I'll have to consult my chartered accountant. I'll have to consult my accountant for this. If they ask you that we have found these documents in your possession, can you explain the documents? You can always say, I do not remember them at present. I cannot recall what is the statement. I will have to verify and then I will tell you later on. So these pleas you can take, but you cannot deny to give the statement. Can the team force you to give a statement in a particular manner? That is practically what happens. Jewelry is found. They will say, are you declaring this in your wealth tax? You say no. Say, please say that this is undisclosed. Are you bound to give that? You can always take a plea. I am not at present in a position to explain the entire source. I will see that, verify it, and give the details to you later on. That plea you can always take. That all this jewelry is accounted for, but at present I do not have the details. So you can make an evasive statement, that is permitted. They will try to corner you, they will try to frame the question in different manners and try to get that answer what they want to. So you have to be very cautious about it. And in fact, in a search, what is happening is, it is a game of patience. How much patience, how much perseverance can you show at that point of time? The search, when they start, they will start at sometime about 7:30 in the morning. Till about 10, 11 at the night, they will not ask you anything. They have preliminary statement, later they will leave it, and then they will do their own work, find the documents, etc., and gather that. The real process starts at about 12 o'clock at the night. The time that you are exhausted. Now is the time when you want that these persons should go away at any cost. So that is the time at about 2 o'clock at the night, the senior officers will now come in. The joint commissioner will walk in and then they will try to pressurize you. If this is all we have found, all this is not declared, we will issue search warrants against you, we will call the excise department, we will refer the matter to the customs department, and they will give you all sorts of threats. And they will then try to pressurize you into admitting the undisclosed income. Now, this is the time when the SSC has to be very cautious. If he can survive that 3-4 hours, then he has won the battle. Right? So, at this point of time, my main caution is that when they insist on making a statement, be very cautious. In fact, what we do in Delhi is that for our major clients who are potential to search, we do conduct certain classes for them, not only for the SSC, but for their entire family. Because the most important concept is that the family member should know what to give an answer to. What happens in most of the cases is that wife may be a partner in so many firms, wife may be a director of so many companies, she may even be drawing salary, but she is not aware of it. तो जब टीम उनसे पूछती है कि आर यू डायरेक्टर ऑफ दिस कंपनी, वो कहते मुझे नहीं पता. आर यू गेटिंग एनी सैलरी, मुझे नहीं पता. आर यू फाइलिंग योर वेल्थ टैक्स रिटर्न्स रिगार्डिंग द ज्वेलरी, मुझे नहीं पता. सो इन फैक्ट आई हैव टू एजुकेट, दैट इज आवर बेसिक जॉब. वी शुड एजुकेट नॉट ओनली द एसएससी हिमसेल्फ, नॉट ओनली हिज स्टाफ, इवन द फैमिली मेंबर्स. दे शुड बी अवेयर ऑफ व्हाट सॉर्ट ऑफ क्वेश्चंस आर बीइंग आस्क्ड एंड व्हाट सॉर्ट ऑफ आंसर शुड बी गिवन एट दैट पॉइंट. So 132.4 is a very important section in the search where the statement will be recorded. And as I told you, this has a lot of evidence value. This can be used against the SSC also. Can the SSC retract the statement? Can he say that this statement was taken under